My name's Nathan Vandenborn, and I'm one of the co-founders and current CEO of Aquamonix. And I'd like to say that I'm by far and away not a good actor or a voiceover, so apology for any stuff-ups I might make through here. Look, as you're all aware, the last 12 months has been quite a changing period for our business, moving from Pentair into Aquamonix. The transition to Aquamonix occurred in November last year after we acquired the three environmental systems product businesses. That was the Tyco Influx flow meters, the Greenspan water quality sensors, and of course, as you know, Rainman controllers. All these products are widely regarded as market leaders within the irrigation and control industry with track records of over 30 years. As a co-founder and the current CEO, I can tell you the leadership's very excited about the opportunities we have in bringing these businesses together. Whilst all of our products present us with exciting opportunities, I'd like to take a moment today to talk specifically about Rainman. From day one with our discussions with Pentair, we made it very clear we wanted Rainman as part of Aquamonix. Having previous experience with Rainman, we're all aware of the potential the business had, given the right level of support and investment. Unfortunately, being lost inside a multinational company, over the past few years, the Rainman team suffered from a lack of investment across nearly every aspect of the business. During the first week after transition to Aquamonix, we had some pretty frank discussions with our customers, including many of you here today, and set about improving three key areas. First and foremost was our customer service and support. Secondly was our product innovation, getting back to transitioning Rainman back to the pioneer in smart control systems. And thirdly, improving our cost position. We're focused on these key areas, and after 6 months, we're already starting to receive positive feedback from our customers, which shows us we're on the right track. Whilst the feedback's been great, we understand we're at the beginning of a journey and can't afford to stop the momentum. We know we've got a lot of work ahead of us, and we're committed to making it happen. In the next few months, you'll see additional headcount within our engineering team to improve product innovation, together with an expanded authorised dealer network to improve our customer service levels. With these additions to an already highly capable team, you'd struggle to find any better hands. Look, I really hope that you guys get a lot out of today, and I encourage you to ask a lot of questions of the Rainman team, and please remember that we are here to make your lives easier. Look, enough talking from me. I'll hand you back over to Don here. And I sincerely thank you for your time today and hope you get a lot out of the day. All the best and thank you.
Okay, well, welcome along to the first of the Rainman Operators and Managers Group meets under the new Rainman Management. And we're absolutely stoked. The box, a couple of our remote councils also streaming live over the internet, so be on your best behaviour going forward. So, as you know, we did go through another acquisition, which I think is number three, back in November. So just to talk a little bit about that and the impact that it has on the product. So we are now part of the Aquamonix group. Aquamonix, so what is Aquamonix? It's an Australian-based proprietary limited company. It's 100% Australian-owned. It was formed in November by the acquisition of some business units out of Pentair Environmental Systems. So as you know, we were part of Pentair. They included the Influx water meter, Greenspan analytical sensors, and the Rainman control systems. The owners of Aquamonix are basically Nathan Vandenborn, who you just met. His role is CEO. Prior to that, he was actually Mark and myself spots in Pentair, so he knows the business quite well. Before that, with Tyco. We also have Brendan Hogan, who is also another ex-Tyco executive. He's involved with businesses such as World Dynamics, WIG, and Aquaspec. And last, we have Wayne Evans. Wayne's also an ex-Tyco executive, very much involved in some of the large manufacturing business. So they're our three owners. They're very approachable, very hands-on, and actually involved in the day-to-day running the business. all based over in Woolpera. Okay, so what is it that Aquamonix actually does? So firstly and most importantly, we have irrigation automation, which is Rainman central control. We also have a hybrid control system there. We have a brand new product that we're bringing into the market for the primary of the East Coast, which is around channels, open channels for the day keeper. We have a new low-cost controller coming into the market this year in the AQ, and also some smart sensors. So all these products here are based on the Rainman technology. The AQ is different, it's a very low-end controller. These are all manufactured still primarily in Perth. We also have a water measurement division. That includes the Influx Magflow meters. So we're still the only remaining Australian manufacturer of Magflows in the market today. A lot of you already use the product, and we're putting a lot of effort into that, making it a lower cost product with shorter lead times, much easier to get. We also build from that plant in Woolpera the analytical sensors. So they're a range of sensors for use in water quality monitoring, be it HEC, dissolved oxygen, all those sort of things. And we've been making those for quite some time. We also have a cloud-based data product, which is our CloudBurst data portal. That allows you to basically read any type of sensor, bring it up to the cloud, and do some analytical work. You can also import that into Rainman. We do that for the baseboard, some sort of machine. There's also Data Link, which is an inland communications portal out there for control systems where we just want one control to the internet. Lastly, we also have a remote monitoring platform. Remote monitoring, these are basically little standalone loggers and data gateways that you can again hook different things up to and bring them up to the cloud. So that's effectively what Aquamonix is now all about. So there's no valves, there's no pumps anymore as we were under Pentair. It's basically everything around the measurement, the monitoring, and the mastering. Okay, where are our locations? So our head office is over in Woolpera, where we've been over there in the water flow plant for some years. We have the control solutions business here in Malaga, which if you haven't been there yet, it's just down the road. We basically build the water quality sensors and the Magflow meters in Woolpera and the other products, the irrigation automation, remote monitoring, cloud-based data, basically right out of the market. We also have a regional office in Shepparton, which is a service centre for both businesses. Going forward, we'll have some other service centres. Okay, control solutions. So let's talk about the team here in Perth. Same team, different name. So effectively, we're the same people that were here prior to the purchase of the businesses by Aquamonix. You know me, I'm Don May. We have Mark Davies over there, who's our general manager, and Dan DeLuca, who's our lead product engineer, both hiding behind coffees in the corner of the room. The rest of the team is made up of Alison Haywood and Andrea Summer, who are our admin staff. We have Bob Sharp, who's here as well. Bob's had a transition of his role. He's now running our production. So Bob is looking after making sure that products get out on time, the bits that need to be on them. We have Jason. Jason's involved technician, so you'll still see Jason out in the field quite a bit, and his specialty, of course, is around. We have Samu. Samu is our primary SCADA support engineer nowadays. So he's the guy that looks after mainly the central control system, but is also helping us to develop some of the other. And the great news today is that we have Engineer X and Engineer Y coming on board. Okay, so we've just finished the interviews. These two guys promised me we'll have some on board next week. Whether they start next week, I'm not sure. But we're actually following on from what Nathan was explaining before in his introduction. Aquamonix are now putting some investment back into controls into the Rainman business. And one of those ways is to give us some more engineering support. Of course, that's to assist in turning our projects around. So very positive news from the change of business. Okay, you may have noticed we have a new logo. So we've retired the old Indian that was around for 20 odd years, and we now have a new improved Indian as our logo. All of our products going forward will be carrying the new brand. We also have a bit of a new look in our business and a little bit different perspective on what we do. So we quickly crafted a mission statement. Those ones. Our mission is to ensure that you, the owners and operators of the Rainman control system, get the maximum benefit from your investment through continuing innovation, quality products and exceptional service. I know that's a fairly big statement, and we may not be ticking all those boxes just yet, but that's what we're working towards. So we do acknowledge that a lot of the people in this room have invested a lot of money into Rainman and been running into their municipal areas over the years, and we're about to make sure that we're actually going to get the maximum benefit from that investment. So it's a much different outlook on the market. Okay, new look, new attitude. So what are we going to do that's a little bit different? We'll just talk about with a new look, a new logo. Importantly, we are going to work to lower costs. So you'll find that the Rainman products, the actual purchase process, will start to come back a little bit. Alternatively, we're now starting to bundle things with those products to give you more value for the purchase. Things like lane switches and so forth, pressure sensors being bundled together with a control. A bit of bang for the money. We're working on shorter lead times. So by moving Bob back into production, what we've actually managed to do is now pre-assemble most of the parts that we need to build a controller. So if Terry Biles, if he rings, there he is, I can say to him, Terry, you can have that controller too, because I can get Bob to build it. Now, we never used to be able to do that for a very long time. That's exactly how short it can be. You can have a controller the same day if you put enough pressure on it. So lead time should not be problem going forward. Also, what we've done there is we're now working with the MFlux water meter factory in North Perra. We're now holding stock in Perth of flow tubes. So no more waiting 4 to 6 weeks for your water meter. It's on the shelf, you can have the same day. Right, it's paired in the combination that we sell with. So between the Rainman controllers and the water meters, we've really worked hard to reduce the lead times for the products. Of course, anything that's highly customised, you're not going to get the same data. There still will be some lead times. So we still have the flexibility to highly customise our product, including the controller and including the water meters. Water quality sensors are basically built towards, so there's just more lead times. Again, we're also lowering the cost on the inputs. So we're addressing the things that the market was telling us. We heard you. We said, it's too expensive, takes too long to get. Okay, we'll fix it. We're also looking at stewardship. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that further on. But effectively, we're engaging with every single part of the market. So not only are we trying to get closer to our customers, we're also working with contractors, with designers, and other people that might have an influence on what we do in the systems. We'll look at that shortly. Improve service levels. Okay, we also heard that we needed to improve our service levels. So we have some strategies we're going to launch today around how we're going to improve the turnaround on service times. So this is a new attitude. So it's a different business that we had 4 months ago. Okay, a couple of little changes around the RTU. If you haven't been seeing these coming through, you might still see them with the Pentair brand. We have a new control being printed, key being printed at the moment. But the fact that it's the same key panel that we've used for 10 years now, except it has a larger four-line display, which is a little bit easier to read, and you can obviously punch more information into that display. We have the new branding, and we've made a little revision on the keypad layout. We won't go too much into detail about that today, but things like, Terry, you were asking about the rain switch being removed. That function's still there, you just need to go somewhere else to find it. So we'll go through that later. As part of our ongoing training, we're also inviting any of your field staff. So if you've got field operators, we're happy to run small little groups in the Malaga warehouse there, where we basically go through the program, the troubleshooting around the RTUs. We can do that going forward. Bob and I were talking about sort of running maybe one a month, just advertising the date and just send people on. Okay, the lower cost products, you're going to find that the Rainman will come back slightly in price. The twin decoder system, we've made some advances there in the way that we build that product and how we purchase the raw componentry. It's coming back in price. We're currently working on some innovation around cable, just to try and bring some a bit of crossing around cable into the market. We have the new RIC wireless system, so we have a new version of our traditional RIC, which allows you to have wireless control in areas like medium strips and other areas where you may not have power or a communications line back to a controller, and you can basically put a wireless node there. We're working around making things very low cost, very low power, so that they can run off any Rainman controller. You can put a wireless node at the Rainman and another one where you want valve, and you can latch up to 8 valves from that. We've used this in ag quite a bit. That's a very established product for us. We're now just changing to make it more suitable for the market. The lower cost is also around the water meter combos. Now, you all would have got a bit of a promotion that we've released recently, where we've not only reduced the cost of the tube, but also the transmitter. We're actually working on that transmitter at the moment, and going forward, the sale will finish on the tubes, the price will go back up, but you'll find that transmitter will be around $1,000 moving forward. We're actually working on ways to make it cheaper than it is now. And so it will make a magfly meter not that much more expensive than some of its less accurate cousins. Okay, shorter lead times. Currently, most controllers, 1 to 2 days, means I don't have to buy Bob copious amounts of tea and pies to get in the building half a day. Basically, 1 to 2 days is quite a reasonable lead time for us. All the peripherals, so things like pressure sensors, decoders, wire connectors, all those sorts of things should be in stock. You shouldn't have to wait for it. It should be just a while. Influx meters, we stock a range of influx meters, so we do not hold every single configuration that we make, because there's the calculation we did recently is 172,000 different permutations of the influx meter. We hold basically from 50 mil to 150 mil tubes in stock, ready to go with the transmitter. All flange table there, plastic, I guess. And we're also adding engineering support now to try and lower the lead times when we have upgrades or issues or things we need to fix to allow us to turn those around. Okay. At each end of each segment, we're going to bring up a little discussion slide. What that gives us is a chance for the group to give me some feedback around the things we've just seen. And at the end of this event, we're going to have a much more open forum. One of the things we really want to try and get out of these meetings is we'd like you, the operators, to actually start to take control and a bit more of where it goes in the market. If you want things done, if you think that we can add some features into the system, tell us, and then we can look at putting that in place without the need for investment. So we're trying to give you control back again. That's how it used to be. Okay, so.
Oh,
sorry. Yes, Tom?
That's a really good point. Any councils, have they introduced something different than what else? Is there anything that anyone else got specifically?
I've only talked to a few of you personally about this idea. Currently, yeah. Yeah, so I think what we probably need to do, Don, is maybe have some sort of a discussion board somewhere that lives, and that, you know, if Sterling have come and they've said, look, we want to do something specific around, for example, lighting control, right? Was an innovation. Oh, yeah. Correct. So, you know, we're working on some other projects with some other councils. I mean, Terry, we're about to put one of these RIC systems in, Terry, in site to see how that operates with him. There's probably some other innovations, Mark. Maybe you could put anything we know that we're doing that's a little bit different. kept secret, very good kept secret.
Well, I suppose for years we've had systems in the south of Perth which do a lot more control from the weather, which is instant weather warnings where we actually, to the stage that they actually we can send staff home when it gets too hot with the weather. And that's a system where they use the weather station and go through some algorithms to feed into the system and work out what the weather is based on some of the information from their staff partners as to how the sort of temperature should be working. And the idea being that once the temperature gets to a certain heat, with the humidity community being a certain temperature as well, we'll actually send SMSs out to the irrigation leads and the irrigation management once it gets to a certain temperature, just to say, look, the temperature's out 45 degrees, something like 40 degrees, the humidity is a certain temperature, you may want to think about your staff a little bit. It's just HR department there, which really wants to get that. That's one thing they've got there. A lot of you have got all your different customized irrigation report systems, which is most of you know as your global bulk reports. You've actually, each of you, probably about three or four different clients have got different varieties of that, which there's some features which some people have chosen, some features which other people have chosen, which will probably turn to the global report. And there's some of the major things you've got. Obviously, City of Stirling have got lighting control in a lot of their systems. King's Park has actually incorporated a lot of that lighting control, and we've actually recently started controlling the main war memorial lake there with the gas lamp, the gas fire, which is their perpetual fire. And we're actually monitoring all the gas levels and water levels and getting the water up in that level because if the water gets too low, the actual gas overheats and the thing shuts down. So we're looking at a lot more tank control situations by working through with Kings Park and through the other council where our control system actually monitors the level in the tank and actually can start and stop irrigation, start and stop tank or based on the tanks. So we're not only going to be monitoring your bores, which we've been doing for years and years and years, just as a basic low level switch, we've started installing bore level probes. So you can actually see a static water level inside your bore and then shut down irrigation on low static water level. Now, the shutting down your on low level has always been done with switches, but this allows you to actually see your trends and actually see your core drawdowns and recharge runs actually start to start stacking that irrigation as well. We're doing that with a couple of councils. And of course, we've got we've been running a lot of our controllers, particularly up in Darwin. Yes, up in Darwin, we've been quite a while, we've been putting a lot of our controllers on solar power systems as well. So they've actually been getting specific from the smaller sites. You put about 40 watt panel we've been using up on the site, which keeps the systems powered. We've actually really innovated and modified our main platform, our main server board quite recently, just in the last year, and managed to drop the power requirements by about 25%. So that's the same for our smaller solar systems as well. Yep. And I've just been told to slow down, so don't think of it.
My original question was, it's more about programming. Like, if you put something up where a lot of some other councils have changed the way they're working.
Yep.
So, what I want to know is, have the other councils aligned with their reporting up with the license that they have to report to the company? Kind of like that's what we're trying to do.
Yes, just for people who are dialed in as well, you said Don Loaf and Sterling asking if people are aligning their global volume reports with the reporting. They are to a degree. It purely modifying reports to whatever format people want to be. Some people are reporting multiple sites but are connected to one license. So we've actually got our reports which automatically go through and sum or average areas and then we'll add them together and then put in different lines in their data so they can work from that people for that. Most of them go through and probably sum that data. I haven't gone to a stage of automatically integrating their data in with the reports. That's definitely possible.
So no one's done that. That's the sort of thing I was.
Yeah, as I said, that's something we haven't done yet, but that's definitely this is something for forming a group such as this discussion today, which we can definitely move on to, especially with our new engineers providing shortly to get that to work.
So I mean that's a good initiative, Don. So, again, if the group feels that there's more requirements around it, say compliance reporting or software to make that easy and usable tool, then we should just be a program in that. But yeah, anyone else got any more thoughts? Things I'd like to see done? It's a good time now to raise it.
Daniel.
Send some feedback from the
webcast. Yes. I'll try and get Martin to slow down until I gave him coffee this morning. So
it's always a bad idea.
And if anyone asks a question,
thank you, Dan.
One more question.
Don Lowe from Stirling. Yes. Again.
Well, the Scott in production. What's happening to the service department?
Okay. So we're going to talk about that in just a second when we talk about the new initiative we've put in place, Don, to actually give us more service in the market. So we still have the ability to respond with our team if we need to. So Bob's not exclusive in production. If we need him to get him out, we can send him out. That's no problems. But in a couple of slides' time, we'll go through exactly what I need to do there. Andrew Blake from Perth Zoo.
I'm just wondering if there are anything new on the horizon in sensors, maybe other industries.
Yes, so later in this presentation, we're going to talk about some of the things that we see coming for the future. And sensor integration is quite important. Yeah. But for your application, where you have now you have a system in your zoo that's just at the moment controlling irrigation and managing the water source. Because of the way Rainman is absolutely very versatile, there's a whole range of other things that we could be plugging into that system to help you manage your site. So Rainman is a SCADA-based platform. We can really make it do anything we want it to do. You know, if you want to have it monitoring noise levels or temperature or something else, if you want to have it looking at pond levels in enclosures, it really isn't a problem. We can just integrate those sensors in, and then we write the programming in the background to actually do something. So, again, you know, your site's a little bit unique in this group because of what you actually do on the site, but absolutely, if you want us to look at integrating things in, it's no problem. So we just need to understand the application, we need to understand the sensors we're working with, and come up with something that works. You're a unique site because you're quite a compact area. You know, it's not a big area. So if we wanted to put people counters in, we can monitor anything we can get a pulse or some sort of voltage out of, we can effectively read that. So absolutely, if you want to measure traffic or you want to measure how many people go in certain enclosures, there can be counters put in. And what we do then is we might use a standalone data logger to record that information, but it's going to be channeled back through Rainman to the central, and then we provide the reports. Same as we would have automated, effectively. So, yeah. Good question.
Basically, we have done systems in the past where we've used our auto gate lockout systems, where you actually, where our controller, through some of our facilities control systems, can allow access to buildings, can allow access to gates areas in particular times. And then you can just have a basic pulse counter as per almost what you have when you go into a building like this, where it beeps every time you go in. You know, it's a system like that which actually outputs the data and counts each bit of traffic that people go through and gets to know when there's people in or even a movement sensor to know when people are in particular areas, and that can be integrated directly into your control system and put back up to your central control and lots sort of access as well.
The other thing we do in some other areas is we mark this indicated before is to take weather data, and instead of just looking at the weather data for use in managing your irrigation schedule, you can also look at it for your HR. So we can say, hey, look, it's now got to a point where the UV is at a point and the temperature is at a point that's not suitable for people working outside. You can talk to your employees, send out automated alarms. You could be doing the same thing in the zoo. that temperature stuff coming back, and you've got a weather station. You can bring in that global data, and also put smaller climate stations around that might just measure temperature with UV in other parts.
That's actually pulled out from a lot of agricultural work we've done in the past as well, where we've actually had a lot of nursery control systems where you're monitoring depending on which we're in. Perth, probably not quite like a frost that much, but definitely over Eastern, particularly for Tasmania, some of those areas we are. And we also have a heat protection, so once the heat gets to a certain temperature, it will have some irrigation, some sprinklers at particular stations to allow you to cut down the heat, which can be used obviously in nurseries we've been used in the past. But in, for example, the zoo could be used in animal enclosures. So if it gets to a certain temperature or certain humidity, it will have a system which cools down the animals there as well.
There is also software out there that can predict the diseases.
Yeah, just one of the things with one of our directors, Wayne, which Dylan mentioned earlier, one of the things he's actually tasked us towards doing is being a lot more of that more intelligent information into our systems, some more predictive information, data modeling into our systems. So that's the sort of thing that we can get some of that information from the scientists, from the universities, and integrate some of those algorithms into our control systems. There's no reason why we can't do some of that predictive stuff as well, and that's something we're looking into.
We as Mark alluded to, in the ag space, we have something called decision support software running, and that can say, hey, look, we've got some weather climate monitors in your apple orchard, for example, and we've detected that over the last 3 days, you've got conditions that are conducive for black spot to occur. Now, our system doesn't do anything about it, just tells you. But the good thing is, once you bring that data in, you can do something with it. And Don, this leads on from your question. Now, once you bring the data in, what Andrew and Josh at the zoo want to do is completely different to what we might want to do in South Perth or somewhere else. You know, it's just a matter of working out what it is. And I mean, it's all quite possible. It's just a matter of working out what the application is. Can we get the sensors to do it? That's the tourism.
Why I ask this, because I'm sort of Terry like the same thing as I do, as in recording.
Yes.
If we had it all lined up, it's a huge step.
Correct. Well, we sort of do that for it in a way. Yeah, we produce a report and some automators every now and then. But, you know, it can then, it is the city of Swan, so they can actually bring that information in a table or an Excel spreadsheet or something like that, Don, and either have a report spat out or just send the data off to them. That's not very hard to do. It's something we can do, and we can make that a priority to get that as a software patch.
And is the council that we agree on.
Correct.
That's what I mean. We need to know if there's any different between the software
that. Yes. And from our point of view going forward, you know, if we've got enough people going to adopt that, our investment in time to make that happen is a lot lower than if we're just doing it for one council. Yeah, correct. Okay, any questions on the team? We'll look at a bunch of photos, aren't they? No? Our mission statement, we are committed. Aquamonix are committed. The owners are committed to making Rainman a much better product in the market. The new look, that was sort of coming under Pentair, the rebranding is the new keypads, the bigger screens. We've had some really good responses in the market from that. Lower cost, I'm sure no one's going to complain about slightly lower cost in the market. And the stock. We're already seeing that having increased levels of stock is paying off for us, and it's making your lives easier too than it's been quite so far in advance. Okay, so I think we're done with discussion time number one. Okay. We're going to talk now about the stewardship. Don Sterling, this will lead into the service shortly. But the first thing I want to talk about is a new program that we're launching called the Certified Installer Program. What we discovered was that a lot of the problems we were having with our systems when they were installed, so this is peculiar to councils that are have a lot of new development, like Swan, for example, Rockingham, others, whereby new estates go in, the developer might actually buy the equipment and you end up owning it at some stage. And we were having a lot of problems with commissioning errors, little things that would just cause the system not to function that it should do first. And we send our service team out and we found out there is simple things like wire connectors either completely missing or not installed properly. It's horrific, absolutely horrific what we found. So what we've decided to do is invest some time and effort into taking control of that installer base a little more. So we're launching this program. Basically, what the Certified Installer Program is all about, it's engaging certifiably qualified companies to be certified as our approved contractors. So it's not going to happen. Your Jim's mowing guy probably won't get a Guernsey as a certified installer. We're going to be looking for people that have the capacity to undertake the work, have got all the right insurances, all those sorts of things in place, but also are able to be trained and continue to be trained in the new technologies as they come along. One of the big problems in the Perth market specifically is that, these contractors have a high turnover rate of staff. So you've really got to try and pick a champion somewhere to train so that they can keep an eye on what's happening. Okay, so there'll be a minimum number of suitably trained staff and qualified staff on hand to ensure that your system is installed correctly. It'll be an ongoing program, so this won't just happen once. We'll do this every 6 months, every 12 months with that particular contractor, depending on what needs to happen as to their turnover of staff. What we're looking to do is to have a level of quality assurance at the end. So, we'll come up with some sort of certificate that they can write to give you, the customer, that this has been installed to specification, the Rainman specification. We may have a position where we go and do some checks and balances as we're getting to know those contractors. In return, all those Rainman certified contractors will be eligible for special pricing from us. So again, this is not your day-to-day work. This is the projects that you see installed out there in some of the newer states and so forth. So we'll give them some special pricing. We'll give them some other incentives. We'll make it worth their while to be part of this program. You, the operators of the system, can nominate those contractors. So you can say, hey, look, we normally get contractor X to do our work. We'd like you to get them into this program. And we're very keen. We've got about two at the moment that we've worked through the certification process with, and they've all come from one specific operator. We'd like more. So, again, this is all designed to improve the service level that you get in the market so that the product should be installed properly and that you shouldn't have any little commissioning faults going forward. The rollout, end of this month. So we're looking at this to become a real thing 1st of July. As I said, we've already done the trial. We've got a couple of contracts we've put through some of the training, and we're getting already some good results in the field. Okay, so in summary, we will train these contractors how to install our system correctly. Their certification will require annual or sooner review. There'll be a QA procedure to sign off. And we'll reward the contractor for being part of that program with the ability to make a little bit of margin on the product sort of into those systems. You can ask for those tenderers to be certified as an installer. So what we'd like to see is a point where the value is added to this program by, you might say, look, you must be a Rainman certified contractor to install this product. Because you do get a lot of people trying to get in and get into this market who have just got no hope of putting these things in, got no hope of understanding what they're doing. Okay, so that's the qualified, certified agent. The contractor. The next stage is the service agent. So, Don, this is addressing the point that you raised before. So we know that as we grow our business, we either need to put on another 10 technicians will find another way to service our products in the market. We believe that we've found a very good way to do this that will allow us to offer a much higher level of service and at lower cost. So here's how it's going to work. We will engage suitably qualified companies, again, to act as our service agents. I'll have a minimum number of suitably trained staff on hand to handle the inquiry. Sounds a bit like the other program, right? but it's a little bit different. There'll be ongoing training. You still book your service through us, okay? So you still come directly to us and say, hey, something's happened. I need someone to attend the site. We'll give you a guaranteed service time. So we'll look at having a same day, next day, whatever it needs to be in place. And then we will have agents. So suitably qualified people, normally they'll be some sort of electrical contractor, that we have trained and we've enabled to go out and service that system. We'll have two at this stage in Metro Perth. We're proposing one in the northern suburbs and one in the southern suburbs. Again, you can nominate who you would like to see in that program. If we need more than two, that's okay. Again, the rollout into this month. So basically, how this program works is that we'll train them and then we'll authorise them to go and do that work on our behalf. So not only are we training them how to change out equipment, but they'll be able to do some basic programming in the RTUs. They'll have full diagnostics available to them. Basically, they're an extension of our business. So, there'll be a QA procedure at the sign-off. So again, it's all about accountability. We're going to make sure that when these systems are running forward, that they're doing everything they need to do. Central booking, again, you'll book it through us, and we'll pick whichever one's available to attend quickly. We'll also supplement this with our own staff. So if we have had a lightning storm or something like that, and there's a lot of repairs to do, then it will be all hands on deck, effectively. So just in closing, that's where we're looking at with the installers, taking a little bit more stewardship with them to make sure things are put in properly, and also bulking up our back-end service with the service agents. Now, Andrew, it's fair to say that this certified installer program would have been a big benefit prior to your system going into the zoo, correct? So there's a classic example, we won't mention any names, where the contractor has used labour hire primarily to do a lot of work. And the results have been cleared. So, we want to get away from that in future. The idea of having the service agent is, these will be companies of the like of Greenlight Electrical or someone off that ilk that is a fairly sizable company, and we will enable some of their staff, we'll take them under our wing, train them, their vans will be kitted out with all the stuff they need so that when they attend, they should be able to fix the problem. We're going to hold more of the spare parts that we may need, radios and other things, if you're still running radios, modems, so that we can fix the problems. So that's where we're going. Some of the future programs that we have in plan to undertake as well include working with the designers and specifiers. So again, that when these new systems are designed, that all the right information is given. Again, there was, Andrew, sorry to pick on you, but a lot of things that we could have done at some of the last installs if the designer had actually thought through the process. We're also going to put some stockist resellers in place into everywhere, not just into Perth, but also on the East Coast. These guys won't actually be selling Rainman RTUs effectively, but they'll hold wire connectors and decoders and some lightning protection units that you may want on a regular basis. So you should better go down to your nominated retic shop, whoever's won your tender, and say, I need a Rainman decoder, and they should have one on the shelf. I need some wire connectors, they should have them there. I need a UTB to replace a lightning module with one. We'd like to be working with those. And again, they should be nominated by you as to who we should be approaching. What does the stoppers get? Again, we will enable give some discount to them so they can make some margin, it's worth their while. And of course, it builds a relationship with the customer. It won't work on larger systems, but it's just a little bit and pieces that we think it's going to work. Okay, another discussion. So, any comments on what you've just seen around the certified installer program or the other points?
Just a question, Don. Yeah, all the little stuff, say like the retail shops, why wouldn't you say put the MPA or something? I'd say Alex or something like that, just to sort of target commercial products that say don't know about Rainman too much. But if it was at Elliott's or Total Eden, then they're going to start asking questions.
Kevin's Ockley, City of Stirling. So Kevin's question was, why would we have more of a range at the other stockers? It's a great question. I have no problems with offering them other product as well. I guess we were sort of trying to work out where we needed to be, Kevin, you know, because when it comes to very complex things, some of those resellers don't quite get what has to go on. But yes, I think absolutely. Things like controllers, our controllers are now basically out of the box. You get it, you plug it in, it's programmed, you just turn it on. It's no longer something that needs a lot of work to get working to the market. So yes, absolutely, we should have MP8s, maybe some comms packs, those sort of things could be available through those resellers. And if that's what, you know, if that helps in your competitive tendering and other things, then I'm very keen to make that happen. Is that another consensus? I mean, would that help in the market? If we were to talk to the retail shops, LH is one, you know?
The only concern I would have is that tendering process would be
yes.
So that would affect us going directly to
yeah.
Using the
It depends on, like with us at Sterling now, the new direction that they're going in. Say, for instance, Aquamonix basically is a sole supplier for the controllers. So basically, when you tender it, someone else can basically put in for it, but they still have to buy the product from you guys. Like, say, for instance, we have to lead them on the panel. But if they already have the controllers, so I'm pretty sure most councils, depending on contracts, I think, they're going to end up the same. They're like a panel now. So if like Elliot's or Totally have those on there, it just makes it a bit more flexible.
It's what we're going back to the boat. So we're going away from contract panels.
Yeah.
That's usually
I think what we would probably do, you know, we going forward, we see ourselves as a manufacturer, not a contract. I think that's a paradigm shift that we've had in the business. You know, we were very much a contractor a couple of years ago. We see ourselves as a manufacturer. That's why we're looking to grow the service part of our business outside of putting extra staff on. Because we think it's more efficient, we think it's better, we think it's better accountability. Okay. When it comes to how you buy the product, you shouldn't pay more from a reseller than you would pay from us. It should be a price in the market, that's the market price. And if we've made an agreement with the reseller, then that's up to us to take this up.
Oh, yeah, look, I'm not disputing that, because at the end of the day, Elliot's decided to market up more than what you. That's why we have the panel base. Like, our management style's changed with different Swan hours now. Look at going, well, for instance, it's a sole supplier. Okay, they're the only person that has the controller. What happens if they decide that's it, they're not making it anymore, and you've got 400 controllers out there? That's where it came with us. So they were like, okay, this needs to be addressed. Sorted. So if basically Aquamonix decides it, who else has got their controller?
Yeah.
Or say you're not basically going to supply the controllers anymore. Say like, so you're just going to send them out to resell.
Yeah.
That was the other issue that was raised once before. So.
Well, that is, you know, for us to grow our business globally in Australia, we have to look at other ways of delivering these coast region. We don't have a control solutions team that support, so we do use resellers and distributors. When we go into the Middle East, we use resellers and distributors. So we're sort of going to the same platform. First, a little bit unique because it's where the system is developed. So, look, I'm open to both. You know, if you want us to be tendering as a sole supplier, we'll do that. If you want us to enable affiliates or others to be able to.
I was thinking that it's an option then, because as I say, it's you know, some of those, a lot of commercial ones.
Yes.
And you know, there's a control in there, the product out there.
I'll chat about that later on. It's a good idea. Right, what about the service agent programs? Any feedback on that? I mean, so what we're looking to do is I've just named a couple of those contracts that we're talking about right now, where we're going to enable them to carry out quite complex level of service, but again, it must be through the booking, central booking. Anything they do outside of that is obviously their booking. So it's really, for them, it's we will allow them to do warranty work, for example. So it's not like we've just found someone, we're going to train them, we're going to make sure they're equipped, they've got all the knowledge they need, things like, you know, the laptop that they can download, reload code, those businesses. I mean, is that going to improve that service level? Because, you know, it's a common thing we hear, is that we take too long to get on top of things after storms and stuff.
Especially, we can nominate contractors. You know, I think almost everybody now use green light. So, they're already out on site. So,
I think what we're looking at this program for is really around service. So not the install. That's where the certified installer. Could be the same reason.
Yeah, right? Well, no, we wouldn't use them to do an install either. We'd use them just for backup, obviously the same on the controller.
We're looking at this as an extension of what Bob and Jason have been offering.
So as invoicing, we go directly through you?
Yes. Nothing changes. You still send the GAC through, and we respond distance to one of these other fellas coming out. It could be someone in a van with a Rainman sticker on.
Because that comes back to the
process.
Yes.
It works out good because basically rather than expanding your staff, which you guys have always had trouble doing, you have your hands tied, you just expand out to get those companies to work with you as a subcontractor. So we still go through you guys, like every other thing, except instead of using Bob or Jason, they're tied up, it's basically using contractors that move on to use anyhow.
So Kevin and Nick, what we've got is the same answer there. So basically, we're able to channel the inquiry still through the central booking. We're able to respond more quickly than we have in the past. We'll enable these guys so that they can still carry out a high level of service. They're not just someone going to book, they should be able to fix things. And our thing is it should not cost you anything. It should be the same sort of rate that we're charging for this. So I think it's quite a positive step forward.
Does that mean that you'll be guaranteeing
their work? Yes. So basically, if they're there and they're trained, Andrew Blake from Perth Zoo, the question was, would Aquamonix then guarantee the work of the contractor? If they're an authorised contractor, it's the trained staff, they're going there, we've issued a work order, go and do this. It's just like we've done. Yeah. Absolutely 100% would be us.
So with that installation program, you're going to have certified installers. Now, would that be as part of a developer required to use that particular person or that provide system?
So, Nick from City of Swan, so the question was, as part of the certified installer program, would a developer who's installing the field equipment for a Rainman system be required to use the certified installer? That's what we'd like. We would like it to actually be a point where the tender is written that you must be a certified installer or undertake the certified installer program to put this in the ground.
Some of that is out of our hands, it's developing the suburb or the infrastructure.
Understand.
And that comes to the city. So prior to coming to the city, we develop as an option for the user. So do you force the developer to use that particular store on the product?
I think what?
Because our system, we will say, City of Swan, we would want to run that system. We would say, if you install a Rainman system, you must use this store.
Yeah, see, that's where I know where you're coming from. On ours, what we do, which I can see where you come from.
As a developer.
Because it comes into us as well, and we say, yeah, we want a Rainman system, and it has to be this. We put in a clause in that for the developer, so when they submit all the plans, it's basically not approved until they've said yes. We'll put the Rainman in, but when we also put in that it has to be installed by either one of our subcontractors that, recommended contractor, so we put LS totals, or Horizon West, for instance, say they're the contractors we currently use. They're our preferred contractors. So if you're going to install a retic at this development, Somerset Hills, for instance, you have to use one of them. So we give them the option. But also, that thing, if they put a Rainman system in and this certification thing comes in, we'll say if the Rainman system being installed has to be installed by one of these people. And if they don't comply to that, then it doesn't happen. But Stirling might be different to Swan,
yeah, Melbourne, like it is
and so
like
forth. But that's what needs to be put into place.
The important thing is there won't be just one certified store.
Yeah, yeah.
We would like to have half a dozen, for example, so that gives some competitiveness in the market still. Because the developers are going to use someone. They're going to engage one of these landscape contractors. Any one of those people who's named, for example, to do this work. So, what we would like to do is to make sure that whoever wins that work is actually training, and it could be that, you know, we train as they, if the contractor X has put a bid in and gone on to install the system, maybe he has to come and ask and get the training prior to doing it. That's okay. We don't intend to charge for the training. It's not something we would sell. It's just a way of us taking more control of
the system. So we have to serve by storage and
what we would own is the QA side. You know, once it's signed off, it's been installed to a standard. We're going to want to make sure it is.
Because as you know, the super small takes a label.
Correct. That's right. And that was actually the primary driver for this program to come. Okay. Designer, you know, again, we're going to talk with the designers and specifiers just so they're fully aware of all the technology we have, because there are certain things that have been done with our system that would make a lot better. Again, poor old Land Rover that pursued different comms methods. You know, the designer there chose a comms method that probably wasn't the best. We had some beautiful stuff sitting on top that we could patch into eventually. But again, we weren't able to change their mind earlier on. So we're gonna engage with them. The stock is free settled. We've had some great feedback there. So yeah, I'll take that on board. I think that we can expand what they hold. All right. So you've been here an hour already. If you did want another coffee, now's the time. But what we could do is just have 5 minutes talk about it, I think, and then we'll come back and get into some. All right, so hopefully you're recharged now. Okay, the next segment we have going forward is the innovation. So I'm going to use this segment for going forward is to show you some of the new things that we're working on, some changes in our systems or new products that we're integrating. And again, we're going to be listening to you. So if you're wanting to look at new things, you might find them pop up in this in future events. Okay. First thing we're going to cover off today is the changes and improvements that we've made to our twin system. So our twin system is the two-wire irrigation network. It's our decoder system. Okay, you're probably all familiar. Okay, a couple of changes we've made. Firstly, as you know, you can make any Rainman controller into a twin by the addition of a twin decoder driver. You simply add the twin module, you add the new power supply, and you also have a grounding system. So these two ports here are quite new. We have a supply here. Okay. So, you can see this, just for the purpose of those that are remote, we've integrated a new power supply. So we actually have this made specifically for us by a manufacturer. It's a filtering power supply. So it's specifically for use within the twin system. What it does is you can plug 110 volts, 240 volts, so you can use it anywhere in the world into it, and it will spit out 28 volts at 60 cycles. In the process of converting it, it filters the power and makes a nice smooth power source. So we've had some situations for John listing down in Esperance. We've had some interference coming in from VFDs and other equipment that's adjacent to the control system. This will solve it. Because it's 60 hertz, it also extends the capacity of the system. So you get about another 15% more distance you can travel, or 15% more valves you can run by the inversion. So that's quite important. That's the new power supply. We've also taken the step now of requiring that a separate grounding system be installed at each twin site. So the grounding system is connected to the twin driver. What we were finding in the past, again, that the contractors were not earthing the drivers properly to the cabinet. So by installing a separate system, we found that we've actually solved a lot of those problems that we had with the grounding. When our guest speaker, Graham from Erico, gets up later, he'll also be talking a little bit more about grounding in this discussion. So that are the two new things that we require at the at the control regime, power supply, and a separate ground. Okay, the other thing is we've obviously got the standard output decoders, the red caps that we've been using. There's a new version of that coming shortly, which we'll discuss soon. But effectively, we still have the single, the dual, and the quad output versions of those decoders. We also have a new range of sensor decoders coming. So the exciting thing around the twin is that very shortly you're going to be able to read pressure, flow, and soil moisture off of your two-wire system. Bring that back into your controller, feed it back into the central, and use it in your schedule. We've also added a new product here called Line Terminator. We've had a lot of problems with contractors not finishing the lines off properly. They'll just leave a bit of wire in the ground and they're getting shorts and so forth. So that, in amongst other things we've done on the twin, has now cut our commissioning errors down by about 90%. Okay, quickly looking at the standard decoder. For those that you don't know, basically it's a product that we've been selling for 15 years or something. It's made over in the EU, so it's a European source product. It is quite robust. It's suitable for direct burying, so you can just drop it in the ground in the mud, doesn't matter, completely potted. It has an internal gas arrestor built inside, so the big difference with our two-wire system over others is you don't need additional grounding on the wire. So you ground it once at the controller, that's it. You don't need it every 500 metres, as in the case of some of the American products. We give you a five-year warranty infield on the decoder. So if it fails for it, any reason other than poor installation, basically, you get a new one. As I said, it's fully potted, IP68 rated. You may notice that the wires on our decoders are quite, so they're actually a Type 99 military spec wire. That's to do with the gas arrest inside. It makes it a much more robust product. You can readdress our decoders. So a lot of our competitive products, once you've addressed them, that's it. You can never change it. The cool thing with ours is that you can change it 1,000 times if you want. You can also do that in field now. Dan has just fired up over there on our demonstration bench, which we'll have a look at later, our in-field program. So this is a little inverter that you can plug into your car, which means you can actually drive around the site and program the decoders as you go. You don't have to bring them back to the power source. Again, we have single output, dual output, and quad output. What we did last year, just going back, was we started to package the singles in boxes of 10. So that's now a contractor pack. So when the contractors come in, we supply the newest box generally for them. It just cuts down our cost. And we've actually lowered the price of the decoder going forward. So they're now about $35 cheaper than they used to be as a result of that saving. We also include the wire connectors with every single decoder. We're going to talk about wire connectors. And every single decoder now comes with its own wire connector. Why? Again, we're finding contractors that were using cheap things they bought at Bunnings. They were getting good ones, but they didn't know how to install them, or just not using wire connectors at all, putting the wires together. So we thought once, basically including the wire connector, we would remove that problem. And you basically get those free with the decoder. The green cap is the new sensor decoder coming. So it's designed to work in conjunction with the existing two-wire, and basically bring in some of those simple parameters. So we will have corresponding pressure sensors, corresponding flow sensors. You can also hook them up to a water meter, and we'll have a little soil moisture system coming forward in the future. The other product that's quite exciting, it's just about to finish its development, is a new purple cap. This is not purple, I realise, but we changed the colour after I did the slide a while ago. The purple cap is a hybrid decoder. So what that is one decoder that it not only has a single switching output, so it'll turn one valve on, normally a master valve, but you can also read a pressure or a flow in that same decoder. So it's perfect for situations where you have a master valve and you also want to put a flow sensor or a pressure sensor there. It allows you to bring that data back in without the need for extra decoders. The other application is where you would use that is on a filter set. So let's say you've got a flushing filter set somewhere, and we don't want to use the little battery operated controller that they sometimes supply. We can convert this with a specific type of sensor that allows us to flush that filter from the Rainman based on the information that can come in through the code. Again, that'll be available probably towards the end of the year. Line terminators. So these are a new yellow cap unit that we have. We'll cap one over here, excuse me. So that's a line terminator in the bag, complete with its snap locks. What's it for? Again, we were having a lot of problems with systems not being finished off properly. wire just left curled up in the valve box without anything on the end of it. So the line terminator has been introduced to prevent any of those commissioning errors. So we would now require at the end of each line, so each main line or branch line that you take off of the two wire, there must be one of these installed. It has a little filter inside, it cleans up the power a little bit, and also has an indicator, a visual indicator, a light that tells you if the system is active. And they don't cost very much. They're just there designed to actually make the system more stable. We're trying to contract improve it once again, if possible. Okay, the other thing around TWIMP is our problem solvers. Okay, so you've probably seen these kicking around. We tend to talk about them a lot, snap lock connectors. We introduced these around 18 months ago, and overnight we've seen a drop of around 90% of commissioning faults in the field when systems were installed using them. They are almost contractable. There are three sizes available. You can get them for up to 1.5 mil, so that's for your valve. You have up to 4 mil for your decoder, and then a 6 mil version, which is suitable for things like T joints and X joints on the line. Okay, so they are quite easy to use. We'll look at that in a second. And price wise, the list price that you would see charged in the shop: $1.99, $2.99, $3.99. So they're not in no way an expensive connector. They are gel filled, so they're completely waterproof. They can be opened. So one of the big features with these is if you do have to change something, you can actually open it up without having to cut the wire. So your wiring looms don't become shorter over time. We don't recommend you reuse them, as you do take some of the gel out when you open them up. Let's see how they work. Quite easy. So effectively you bare the wires. There's a little gauge on the inside of the opening of the connector. That tells you how long to take the sheath off the wire. Bare the wire, shove it in. You can actually see it in the clear back of the connector there. And then simply squeeze it shut. And it will click. There's a positive click shut to make work. There's some of these in your little goodie bag that you have on the chair. Once you've clicked it shut, the tensile strength of the joint is amazing. So it's very hard to get them up. You can't pull them out. The seal's very good. There's lots of gel in there, so it's a nice waterproof seal. In the case where you want to open it, you simply insert a screwdriver. There's a little slot here, and you pop it open, and it will actually just unlock, and you can take the wires out, do what you need to do, put another one back on. Providing you push the wire all the way in, and you can see that through the clear back of the connector, there is no way that you will not get a perfect seal on this. I mean, we've had some contractors that have tried. Generally, once you show them once or twice how to use it, they'll do it. So they're an amazing innovation. We import them in from the US, so they're a product with the Australian agents from there. Again, you get these free with all of our decoder systems. Again, I'll just quickly go through how it works. You open it up, bare your wires. Sorry for the Americanisms here, guys, but 5/8 is the length, whatever that is. Insert the three or two strip wires into the connector. There's three ports on each one, so you can basically do a joint in the main line plus one off to your decoder or your tuner. Step four, otherwise, and close it and extract. It is again. We'd love to see these being written up in tent to be used as the DVYs, because we're finding a difference in the quality of the insert. Also found, you know, where we've had old existing systems where we've had problems, going back and putting these in has been an amazing thing for us as well. It's cut down a lot of our problems. Okay, next one is the recoil actuators. So again, in your bag, you'll find a little coil. So we introduced this product last year for the purpose of working with our decoder systems. What we're finding is that there is a big difference in the amount of energy that the different valves draw to maintain their position. So, you know, you can go from about 130 milliamps holding up to 210, and that greatly affects the number of valves you can operate at one time. So we introduced the recoil. What that is a coil that will fit just about every valve on the market today. When you get the unit, there is a bag of adapters inside that fit Hunter, that will fit Burmad, that will fit Duratrol, that will fit Rainbird. Okay, so there's not a valve that we know of that won't fit. Without those adapters, it will fit straight away to things like Orbit and K-Rain and Galcon and those other valves. What it does is it gives you a static holding current, so 120 milliamps. So it's a nice low power coil. It's also heavy, it's metal, so it's a heavy duty coil, it's heavily potted. Comes with a nice long lead on it. Again, it comes in a kit with the adapters and also the wire connectors there. So it's available if you're looking to change out, for example, battery valves, where you might want to change battery valves to put on two wire or on our rig. You can go along and use these to re-energize your coils. If you've got situations where you're having problems getting other valves to stay open, you can replace the existing OEM valve coil with a recoil, and it will give you a much better level of stability in the system. The other pretty cool thing is I ran a retick shop before I came to work for Pentair, as it was in those days, and the amount of people I used to have coming on a Saturday morning and tell me, oh, my valve's not working, and you determine it was the coil, and you say, okay, what sort of valve is it? And the answer you got was black. Not very helpful. This one bag, you turn up to a valve, there isn't one that doesn't fit, you have a much lower turnaround time. Again, we'll be making these available through the stockers in the market. Retail price, $19.95. It's not an expensive portable. Okay, Dan, would you like to talk about it? So I'll hand over to Dan DeLuca. This is a brand new product. I'm going to hand some of these around then while we're talking. And there we go.
Okay. Twinkle's new decoder and a solenoid product that we've been working on. OEM supplier for several years now. Just starting to do some installs now for first units. Basically combines a decoder and actuator one. Several advantages of this. First off, there's less cables to connect together, so less wire connectors, less room for error. Second thing is because the decoder is optimized for the specific coil that we've attached it to, it's very, very low power, so we can run a lot more of these one at a time on one system. So, for example, the two-way one here, we can run up to 10 valves on one wire, and our controller can support four wire paths, some of our controllers, so you can run up to 40 of these at a time, potentially. It's got the same inbuilt lightning protection that the standard decoders have, and it's got this very useful light on the top, so you can see when there's power on the line, you can see when the decoder is operating correctly, so you know whether it's an electrical problem or not a problem very quickly. And once again, it comes with all the adapters that you see in your recoil pack, or we have the option of including the adapter to suit the valve that you're using. This one, at the moment, we sell those red cap decoders. At the moment, these twin coils will not work on the same system as the red decoders, but shortly we'll have new decoders that will have blue caps. So we're phasing out the red caps, and they'll be replaced by blue caps, which will work with these coils, and also will be all red caps. So it'll be a product that will let you change over from one system to the next. So there's two variations. We've got the two-way one, which screws directly into most valves with the adapters, most commonly used. We also have an ag version, which does the three-way valves. So master valves sometimes have also systems, so you have the option there. And it's part of ongoing innovation with the twin system, so we haven't stopping here. We're continuing to work with our OEM provider. We're looking at new drivers for these coils, different types of cable spec and stuff like that. We're also looking at different, some newer controllers. At the moment, our controller will run these twin coils alongside multi-wire, alongside the RIC system as well, all on one controller. which is really versatile. We're looking to optimize some controllers just for these calls because they're so low power. We can use low power supplies and make just a more economical system as well.
Can you introduce these solenoids on a time basis as, say, if you've got lots of different solenoids now? One goes, can you change it over to your solenoid, this kind of solenoid, without causing any issues to the retic system?
So Rob's from Hamilton Golf Course, and the question was, can we progressively introduce the twin coil into an existing system? So as your current decoders or your current valves fail, or you want to replace them, can we actually introduce these in conjunction with what we've got?
Yeah, so if you've got an existing multi-wire system and you want to convert it into a two-wire system down the track, you can install these coils in place of regular coils. And if you don't give them an address, so when they come shipped from the factory, they have an address of zero, which doesn't respond to the decoder system, it will automatically power up just like a regular coil. So as soon as you put power on it, it'll light straight away. And it has a different color light to indicate that it's in that mode. And that gives you the opportunity to go through, and even before you turn into a decoder system, you can install these coils. And then later on, you can go and address them if you want. The benefit of using them on multi-wire systems is that they're very low power. They use the same power draw whether they're in decoder mode or in just standard like solenoid mode. And that's about, for the two-way one, it's only about 35 milliamps, which lets you run longer cable runs. So if you're having issues with your cable, sometimes you can put one of these in and you can get it working without having to.
So existing two wire, which I have, there's no issue to put those stuff in those in if solenoids start to go.
You can't put them in existing two wire systems at the moment because with the red cap decoders, there is a little bit of incompatibility. It will probably work 99% of the time. Just that point where I'm set
on a 45 degree day.
What was going to be required, Rob, is there'll also be a software upgrade to your driver that will generally need to happen in the new version. So each current version, you notice they've got a red label, so they're the versions that are compatible with what we're running the full cap. Last week, with the new blue cap program, there'll be a blue label, and then a slightly different protocol. But what they'll allow you to do is you can run these in a hybrid system, so you can have some valves operating with the decoder, these twin twinkles on there, and you can have some valves, let's say the valve and hit sprinklers, or you might have even a pump start or something like that, can operate off the.
What about these sensors you were talking about that are coming in? Is that going to need an upgrade to the central, or the existing central that we've got the other retrofit or not?
We would just supply you a patch, so there would just need to be a little bit of software. It might cost you anything, just a matter of. By the way, we didn't cover off the sensors here, but you can pick up eight sensor addresses per two-wire path. It's possible with that controller to run four or two-wire paths. So you can pick up brightness and pick up another 32 sensors. Now that address, that might mean that if you've got a soil moisture sensor, that's not one of our little small ones, it might have three addresses that you can change.
And there are some situations where you can start installing these in phases, and that's if you have some of our controllers, you can have multiple two-wire paths, so you might have one going that way, one going that way. As long as these coils are installed on one path, all on one path, and there's no other decoders on the path, then they'll happily work with other paths that have red cap. So if you're running a brand new path in that direction, you can install these. That's no problem. But if you're going to retrofit these onto an existing system with the red cap decoders, you need to replace a whole path at a time. That's what we recommend.
Thanks, Dean.
One
more question.
Whether you put in these new coils or the blue cap code is, which you can use obviously with these ones. The controller needs to be software updated. Because obviously you're saying in the interim, if say like what we've done on a couple of hours, we've changed more out now. But if we want to, say, one of the states slowly introduce the blue cap decoders until we get so many through before we can spend replacing the coil. If we integrate the blue decoder with the red one, does that mean the controller needs an upgrade as well, or is it just going to work?
So Kevin from the City of Stirling was just asking about going forward if he's got existing systems operating Redmox to both red and blue. Does he need to upgrade the software in the so Kevin, it's actually the driver, the little board that we put the different software in, so it's not your right name. It's just that little board that makes the upgrade.
Yeah.
And it's purely a firmware.
Yeah. The blue cap decoder will work backwards compatible. So you can just swap them over and that will be fine. If it's an existing system and it's a little bit older, we do recommend that you upgrade the software because there's been incremental improvements to the twin system over time to improve the stability and give you a bit more diagnostic feedback back. So we recommend that you do that anyway, but you can just take a blue cap to go to put it where a red cap is.
the retail price, one of those upgrades is zero, so you don't get one cost for anything like that. Yeah.
Last point there, Dan, sorry, Dan. Programming of that decoder, is that still standard? Or is there an independent program?
You use the same program?
Yeah.
We've got one over there. It's got a different coloured sticker on it. The old programmers won't work with this coil potentially. We're looking at having a retrofit option where you just send the program to us, put a new sticker on it, upgrade the firmware, and then it'll work with those coils. Also with the driver that drives these coils, we're looking at developing a new driver that's got a few improvements to it. That will only be compatible with the blue cap decoder and the twin core. So it'll be optimized for those two devices. So if you're installing a brand new system, that will be an option.
Thanks, Dan. So Graham, you know, just a little picture of one plane installed. It's actually a mixer. So this is an ag version. That's a 3-way. Quite quick to install. Okay, the next thing we'll talk about is our pressure sensors. So last year we introduced a range of branded pressure sensors for the irrigation market. We basically have two types. We have a traditional type of sensor that you'll see installed in most places, which has the Hirschman-style plug. It's compatible with what you've probably got there now. You just take the plug off and put our sensor back on underneath it. It comes with a standard quarter-inch gas thread, which is the industry standard nowadays. Available in 0-600, 0-1000, 0-1600, 0-3600 KPA ranges. That's just quite a nice range of pressure options there. And it has a retail price of $199. It's about half the price of what we used to integrate. So what we've basically done is we've bought these in and we've heavily subsidised them to get them to the market. They've a strong warranty, backup, we hold lots of stock. We have another version, which is the PT05. It's a more compact sensor, so it's slightly smaller. It is technically not quite as accurate as the other one, but to be honest, in the applications that we work in, that really doesn't matter too much. It comes cabled with 10 metres of PE cable and is IP67, so it's rated quite happily will work outside in the elements. So if you've got a bore head or some other something else you want to pick up a pressure point from, or indeed if you want to put it onto a main line, the perfect application to use. Slightly different ranges, they come 0-300, 0-600, 0-1000, but we could make them higher if they're just a little bit more expensive. 249. So they're both available now. We have lots of stock. When we are selling the new Rainman controllers at the moment, we're bundling the rain switch and one of these pressure sensors with the controller as a package. So we basically just added them as a bonus, as a way of lowering our cost of the product. Okay, some of you might be familiar with the IC rain switch. So this is a bit cutting edge technology. It's our version of a rain switch. Quite a few of you have installed them, and some have rolled out quite a lot nowadays. Effectively, it's an optical device. So how it works is very similar to the rain switch that might be in your Mercedes that you all drive. It's got automatic rain control. It's also similar to the technology that you see in your optical mouse. So it's basically working by having lasers inside here, which refract up onto the dome, and we then measure the distortion coming back from the dome. And we can pick up rainfall, not only the presence of rainfall, we can pick up the intensity, so we can sort of measure it as well. It comes in two formats. It comes in a blue disc, which is a simple rain switch. You can attach it to any controller. And it calculates the restart time from the rainfall received. So the difference between a normal rain switch, which is generally sort of a piece of cork inside a little caster that gets wet and expands, this one will not only turn your controller off very quickly, it's very fast acting, which is the biggest problem with the traditional ones, is they take too long to work. It also works out how long before it restarts your controller based on the amount of time, based on the amount of rainfall that's received. And we can change that before we send it out. The other version that a lot of you do install is the green disc, where the device now acts as a tipping bucket rain gauge. So it's now actually a pure counter, and the rain man is then tasked with turning the system off and restarting dependent rainfall. Okay, so both there, both available. Again, we're putting these as bonuses in with their new product signs. Okay, the other thing we have, we'll just go and grab one, is the HMI upgrade kit. So for the benefit of our guys on the webcast, it's a simple little kit that changes your old two-line controller into a very new version. So what you get is the new keypad, you get the new four-line display, you simply unbolt the old panel out, put this in. There's just a small little modification by bending a couple of pins on the board, and we also give you a software upgrade at the same time. That brings you to the latest version of the firmware. That will also allow you to read the four-line display. So that's an excellent way of upgrading your system. So if you've got a lot of old controllers you're looking for a refresh, maybe you don't have the budget this year to put new controllers in, this is another way of doing it. So you can actually go and give it a nice system refresh for a fairly low cost. Installed about $700. So that includes coming out, doing it, and we do the upgrade to the software at some point. Okay, so that's the HMI upgrade kit. Okay, last discussion time. So, any questions around the new twin core? So, the twin system and the twin core are two sort of separate areas, but the twin system upgrade is around the grounding kit, the line terminators, and the new power supply. So, we've added three parts into the twin to make it more stable and to make it a little more contractable. They cost, there's a bit of an investment there, but generally you'll get that back quite happily by lack of problems going forward. The twin coil, the decoder and the solenoid, it's a brand new product, okay? It's something we've been working on for a very long time. It is a lower cost than the decoder. It is able to run more at one time than the current decoder, and it means you just have one part rather than the decoder and a coil, both of which can fail. The pressure sensors, something else that we've integrated. Sorry, about half an hour. The IC pressure in the both the corded and the traditional style. The IC rain, a lot of you have already installed that. If you haven't, come and talk to us, but happy to give you one to play with if you want to have a look at it. And the HMI upgrade kit. So, those are the innovations around the new products. We've got a lot more that we could talk about. We've got a lot of time today. All of these have been taken up by some of you in the room. So, you know, these are things that we've developed through an assessment. Nothing? Yes.
Yeah, I think
the
IC makes sense.
Okay. Chris from South Perth. Okay. What happens with the IC rain sets when birds come and shit on it, basically? Look, what we've found is the shape of the dome, it's quite resilient. It'll handle a bit of that crap on it and such, right? We do recommend that once a year, if you wipe it with something called Windex, which is a cloth. You buy it at all over Amazon. But you know, we haven't had any problems at all with it starting because of birds. Most cases, it's very hard for them to sit on. So it's only if they're a really good shot that they manage to get it from the height.
We probably don't get as much here, but in the east, we get it below dew point. That stopped your system from running. There's a bit of juice.
So that we can make these as sensitive or as insensitive as we choose. So we purposely calibrate them when we send them out. But they do require, you know, if you just sort of wet your finger and put it on there, it won't activate. You've really got to have a body of water sitting on it. Normally these are quite high, they're installed quite high as well, Chris. So you're often above where you've got that inversion layer, you know, when you get the dew forming, but they're normally above that inversion. Don from City of Stirling is just commenting on the fact that the rain switch seems to be less attractive to birds eating than the other plastic products, which is another benefit. It is pretty hard for the bird to rest on there as well. So what can happen, Terry, is depending on how you configure it. So Terry from the City of Canning has asked, how does the rain switch integrate? Does it feed back to the go back to the central? So if you've configured it just as a rain switch, it's a local thing. Okay? It's just going to plug into the sensor port and it's going to shut that controller only off. If you've configured it as a gauge, so the green disc, where it's now tipping bucket rain gauge emulator, we just feed that information straight back into the SCADA, into your central, and that makes the decision to isolate the pulse control.
Sorry. We've got a bit left of field on that subject, but with the decoders, with a two-wire system, you can't locate balance too easily with a two-wire system using the conventional trackers. I know rain bird, you put a valve test on it, using those things, you can actually locate valves.
Right.
Is there any way you can commit to something like that?
So,
plus, like you know, we've got Ellenbrook and that side.
Yeah.
We've got valves, we don't
know. Ed from City of Swan has asked, is it possible to locate the position of valves fitted with the twin coil in the field using some sort of. I'm going to throw it at Dan because that's a really good Dan question.
But it's something we've been looking at for a while. Something we use those bolts.
But you've got to know where your valve is to start with. Someone has to put it in there. If it's not there, and you need to track a valve that you don't know what it is, that system.
Yeah, if it's an existing one of our existing systems, we can't help you without it. But we're definitely.
Well, I don't know if it's by accident, but Rainbird you can. You put a valve test on, put the EMS on, and a traditional wire tracker, you can pick up the coil.
Yeah. Okay. We haven't done that test with that.
I think of me when you make millions out of it.
We have thought about even putting like large ID chips inside. A lot of people are just going to have actually putting.
The experience you guys have is why we've been looking at it.
Yeah.
So much later.
All right. So, any other questions?
High pressure sensors in there. Anyone?
So Kevin from City of Stirling is asking, has anyone installed any of the IC pressure sensors? I'm sure that we have, because we've sold quite a few out there. Terry, you've got some. You've probably even got some in yourself that you've just been putting.
Within 10 metres, so
this one here, you cable yourself, right? So you can do it whatever length you want to be. This one here, we could order that in from the factory with a longer cable if you want, right? But it's very simple just to join it. It's 4 to 20 milliamps coming out, so whatever the capability is going to be, it's the same thing up for 20 milliamps. Okay. So Wayne from City of Bayswater is asking if the twin coil has any reporting of its active or non-active status back to the system. That's another great damn question.
Generally with our system, the controller detects when the coil is activating based on the amount of current across. So it tells the coil to turn on. If it doesn't sense the current goes up, the coil light, draw that current when it activates, then it detects that as a failure. And if it does sense that the coil is activated, then it just carries on. Twin most, yes, exactly. So it's very similar to.
You're thinking of something similar to the SD control, is that where you're coming from? So, SD, if you go in there and you can see a station, what the code is locked on, it has tick.
So the ones that basically, at the moment, we can't detect if it's fouled unless we try and activate it, either during irrigation or just doing a manual test. We've been looking at having a test program that just automatically goes through test the valves. That obviously won't work to pressurize the system, but that would run automatically, periodically, and then report back. Yes.
Right, so we're going to bring in our guest speaker. We're going to do this every event. We'll bring someone else along to have a chat to us and try and pick a topic that is of interest to you guys, not to us, mostly. So I thought that one of the most pertinent things that we get asked about all the time is what happens in lightning storms in Perth. And so we're going to bring Graham Oakey from Pentair Erico along to chat. We have, in the last 6 months, basically changed all of our lightning protection in our new control systems over to the Erico product. It is a more modular product than what we used to use. It is a slightly higher capital cost, but going forward, it's much easier and much cheaper to replace if you've had a lightning strike. We've also found it to be very, very robust. So I'll get Graham up. As you know, we use the kind of Pentair. Erico were purchased by Peter about the time as we were sold, but we've retained that good close working relationship. Right.
What the three areas that I mainly look after is lightning protection, grounding and bonding, and surge protection. And we also do design work. So we design lightning protection systems and earthing systems as required, and surge protection for different systems. We work under a thing called the 6-point plan, which we've had for years, and one or more of these things might apply to your installation. So it's one of the first things to try to do at a larger installation or a tower or a facility is capture the light at an unpreferred point, conduct it down the ground, dissipate the energy safely into the earth, eliminate earth loops, detect incoming power lines, detect incoming telephone data. So it's probably the last two apply to your industry more than anything, but the earthing is important as well. And on a larger installation, this is how we do it. We look at the lighting protection, how to get it down to ground. We bond all this together. We look at surge protection on the incoming mains, any copper lines that come into it, surge protection. And then we try to bond all this together where practically they're too far apart, wouldn't work. But basically, you can apply that theory to just about any installation, be it big or small. Most lightning damage can be traced back to one of these things, either no direct strike protection, incorrect earthing, which we see a lot of. We see a lot of places that aren't earthed properly, you have multiple earths where you get earth loops through buildings and installations. Insufficient or no surge protection and filtering. I'll go into surge protection and filtering in a while, and insufficient protection on data line. We see a lot of places where they do all the mains, but then they don't do the telephone line that comes into the fire alarm system. And surge comes in the fire alarm into that wire and blows it up. And the consequences, well, you guys probably know about most of the consequences, but electrically, be unsafe for staff, equipment damage, fire, and operationally, obviously, downtime, loss of data, data corruption, and eventually all this usually goes to loss of revenue. Our friends from Western Powers, they blame lightning for most things. This is their chart, not ours. And obviously, there's other things that affect the power that comes into your facility. But lightning is obviously one of the biggest effects you will have on the power system, both underground and above-ground lines. Some of the damage that you'll see, this is a...
Sorry, could you just go back? Community, which one's community? I can't see it. I'm not
sure. Oh, it's like much better. This one here.
That's community. Oh, yeah. That little one.
Yeah.
That's the big one. The big one.
Barely.
All right, okay. Cheers. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So, is it? Sorry, my eyes aren't
interesting. So what, the big one is humidity.
Yeah, that'd be right, you know, okay. Where that pole flies now.
Yeah,
that's right. Cool.
Sorry about that.
That's cool. Yeah, look, a lot of the damage that you'll see won't be as obvious as this is NT News in Dale when they got hit by lightning. That was their MDF or blew it. And sometimes it's just a little pop on board. Either it'll take the system out. It's a fire alarm panel. Yeah, hospital, they had a lot of problems there. Again, they weren't covering all the protection of the AC power going into these things and the communication lines that are going into it as well. So how does the surge get in there? Well, obviously, direct strike straight onto your power line. Get hit the ground, get induced into the underground line. And you have what you call capacitive coupling. Particularly with if you've got antennas and things like that, you don't have to have it hit it, go into the ground. If there's enough electrical field in the air, you can capacitively couple into your system or into your antenna or whatever. It all depends on the amount of activity that's around at the time. How we look at most facilities is we look at a point of entry protection. So we have what we call a shunt diverter. There and then what we'll do then is we'll put like an SRF, which is a surge reduction filter, and a surge reduction filter is from 3 amp right through 3 phase, 2000 amp, depending on the installation. We have a big surge reduction filter on the front end here, that'll have the built-in chunk in it already. This is an old slide, but we're now finding things like air conditioning and LED lights, we're probably starting to look at putting filters on those as well, and it's susceptible to damage. What surge protection does too is to knock out these big spikes that you have on. This normal sine wave that you have on a standard 240-volt system, it's not there to look at temporary overvoltage. Surge protection is looking at knocking these big spikes out that are going to damage your equipment. So you get a big spike on the line from the switching train. That's what we're trying to do. Knock these big guys out, like temporary over voltage, brownouts, and that. So third protection from that there to by that other devices that you have that telecommunication lines and anything that goes out, you protect either end of this. And if you've got remote sensors or remote control type stuff, you need to remote them. Otherwise you all these shunt converters and filters and barriers down to low quality require an earth. If the earth is 300 or 400 meters away, something like that, so you need a lot of earth. It could be better just to rot in the ground or whatever it is locally, it's better than that. You again, same kind of principle, and you can see here the earth is out there. And this is a long run. I've put a third testing device at either end. AC power is covered, telecom communications in and out, which is covered as well. So it's all about barriers against surge coming from outside and anything that's live in the building. The UCB range, the universal transit barrier, is probably our biggest seller for all our extra low voltage stuff. How you size these things is you've got to have some clamping voltage above the working voltage. So it's 20 volt system, go to a UTB 30. And if it's a 12 volt system, you go to UTB 15. We've got different configurations for these things. They can come in duals and singles and whatever combination you want. They're repairable on site. This bit, if you have to still got a circuit through it, if you haven't got a spare and the unit's been hit by something pretty big, you just take it out, you still have your circuit through until you get a replacement module.
So Graham, just to reinforce, so I've just passed a couple of these UTVs around. So the important thing here, this is what we're fitting now to the Rainman system. So if you have a bed, it's easy to go on one of each lines, they'll at least end up two lines each. Put your multimeter over it, work out which one's live. The moment you remove the module, so the moment you remove the UTB module, that's now active again. So the system should work for you. You can simply go and replace that module to give you a lot of protection in the future if you don't have that one. So that's now standard on all the Rainman systems.
Yeah, so they're a pretty simple device. Obviously, you've got a size to your voltage. Most of them are, they're the ranges there. 2 amp, up to 2 amp. We can do bigger things if you've got them, but most control stuff will be over 2 amp. So, great two wire in, two wire out, and then skim roll mounted. We've got other data protection type devices, the range, we've got this landline as well, and Argo 45, BOE, C6, all that type of stuff. Again, land Argo 45, BOE, and I know people always use that in the industry. There's a configuration right up for coaxial, CCTV, all this type of stuff. And obviously the UTB range, which is probably the most popular one that we have in standard for let's say through a little bit of basic grounding. I mean, basic grounding can be anything from just an earth rod in the ground, to multiple earth, to radial earth, to when we're doing light protection, we do a lot of deep pool earth, trying to get very low resistances. Trying to get rid of a lot of energy, but it all depends if you've got a reading you're after, like under 10 ohms, under 5 ohms, or under 1 ohm. Most of the time, if you're just doing the remote cabinet, all you want is an earth, you don't need it. It'd be nice to get under 10 ohms or something like that. But in reality, around Perth, maybe not going to get under 10 ohms, probably 2 metres, probably going to have to go to this system with a lot of light and protection. But most of the time, they're deep through it. Spectral, this is a compound. That's how we get low reading. Or we go out and have a bigger earth platform. But just a remote cabinet, simple rod in the ground, it's going to be fine. complex earth systems around can have a whole grid around it, say a facility, and lots of connections and ways of lowering the resistance. I'm not sure if that applies to any of your installations, but if you've got a bigger facility, what I'll do is earth grid around it, bring it into one earthing point, and have all the earths in the field and come back to that one. So that eliminates earth loops and all the faults that we see in larger installations to do with multiple paths, the lighting to come in and go out. A bit of basic stuff on light protection. We've got three main systems that we use. Conventional systems, system 2000, 3000, the isolated system. At the larger installations with big contrasts, and the smaller installations we've got a thing called Erico. A lot of lightning damage is not as obvious as that. A lot of places we see that we don't see this type of damage. We might get a little small burn mark on the mask or whatever. And sometimes we don't see anything other than they say, hey, it blew up. So a lot of times it's not as obvious as that. Our lightning is formed, as most of you know, it's formed once the cloud gets full of particles, it then starts to shoot out what we call downward leader. When this electrical field gets big enough, it then electrifies what's on the ground. The highest thing you get electrified first, and then once we've got enough the conditions are right, we've got upward leaders, we've got downward leaders, and they'll connect together. As you see in this slide, there's an upward leader there, and one there. By knowing all this, that allows us to design light protection systems, but we say, hey, you know the highest point is going to be hit, you know the form of the building is going to be hit. So we can design. So a typical old conventional system, which we still do, they'll look at lightning rods all over, connect it all together and get it down to earth in multiple locations. Some of the newer systems, we just have a single terminal, a single big conductor comes down to earth. Spinal horses and horses, lots of towers we do for defence and bureau med map, we use these systems, big sheds and things like these systems. There's no wrong and right way to depend what it is, do you want it isolated or not. So, out of all that, we have our own design software, so we can design for all those different types of systems, and AS768 light protection standards for Australia. So we can design for all that, and out of that we can then where the air terminals go, and then how we're going to get it down to earth near the ground, the safest one. So it's a pretty old drawing. We don't do it like that anymore. But basically, we have terminals all over this. Again, on the highest points, on the corners, we connect it all together, and then we can just run that as much down the outside of the building. So we use columns to seal it somehow. And that's a mechano-centric type approach to doing it and still use it this time. Newer systems, these are called dynamic air terminals, and the conductor, again, bigger protection radius, work that out, take it down, shoot it down into an earthing system that can dissipate the energy. But a new one called ISO-DC, insulated system, that we mainly use in communication masks and antennas, but we just started to use loading magazines and things like that. So basically we can run cables next to this. We've just done some big lighting towers in Dale. We can run this down the centre of this cable, and you can run the lighting control cable next door with the one induced from one cable to the other with the bare older system. So if you put the designs into ways that so really the main steps for looking at protection is first and foremost to design your surge protection when you come out and you're done for all your copper lines. It's all about putting barriers in the right position, making sure your grounding and earthing systems are all together if possible, but both of them, and to make sure your remote control panels are earthed. And assess if you need light protection. Not a lot of installations you don't need light protection. You're more than likely need surge protection, and obviously you've got to drowning alert systems, but a lot of installations you don't need light protection, but if you've got tool masks or high risk areas or fire installations and all that. I blew through that pretty quick. I was under instruction. It's a pretty, it's not that difficult to do, and if any people have got anything you want me to have a look at, I'll put some business cards up there, and obviously we've got installation. We've got problem installations, we can give you some advice on that, and we've got surge protection for you, and obviously you can change what you've done in these people.
Thank you, Ryan. Any questions for Ryan? Look, thanks for coming on, Graham. We've been working with Graham now for almost a year as we changed over to the Erico system. And one thing that I'm very, very happy about, Graham, is that he is available to come and speak to us or to you to look at sites. If you've got problem sites where you're having some issues with losses due to lightning, give us a call. We'll arrange Graham with you. We import and stock the products that we use every day, so we always have stock in hand. So if you've had a lightning event, there should be no reason we can't supply replacement parts pretty quickly. All of the other things that Graham is talking about with regard to filtration and other things, look, we're very keen. If there's applications that you've got, let's work together and we'll solution them out. Okay, thanks, Graham.
Thank you.
Cheers. We'll be right back.